Hey, everybody. We got a great question come in about lifting all 10 toes up off the floor. And this question is asking about this both in a yoga context and also in a strength training fitness context. So this question was submitted by Nancy, and here is what Nancy said. When doing chair pose, you spoke about how it can actually be beneficial and strengthening if the knees are bent forward over the toes, and that it's a myth that it's bad for the knees. So first of all, yay, I'm so glad that Nancy got that out of what I said about chair pose. I totally agree, and I think that's true and an important insight for us. But anyway, back to what Nancy was saying. I'm a dinosaur now in this industry and was always taught not to bend the knees past the toes. So my question is, here's the question, should we refrain from telling students that they should be able to lift all 10 toes off the mat and drive through the heels? I still hear this cue in some yoga classes, as well as in weight training classes when performing squats. Great question. So I can also attest to having heard this cue many times in the yoga world. I have not experienced it like to be super common and to be taught everywhere, but in some yoga schools, it is kind of a typical or a common emphasis to emphasize this lifting up of all 10 toes. So if I were just to summarize my perspective on lifting the 10 toes, it would be that I do think this can be a helpful cue, but it just depends on the context. So in general, I think that lifting all 10 toes can be good for awareness building as far as helping students feel how they are distributing the weight across the rest of their foot. So lifting the toes up just gives an opportunity to then feel through the rest of the foot and kind of notice like how you're carrying yourself there. So there's something called the tripod of the foot. You may be very familiar with the tripod, but the tripod of the foot is 3 points: inner ball of the foot, outer ball of the foot, and center of the heel. And these are 3 points that form a tripod or a triangle. And the idea is that in general, it's a good idea to try to feel that you're grounding down through all three of those points. Like whenever you're in, say, standing poses in yoga, when you have your feet on the floor, like can you connect to the tripods of the feet? And the tripod is helpful to connect to in strength training exercises. So yes, I do think that lifting all 10 toes can be a helpful way to facilitate tuning into your weight distribution in the rest of your feet. And so I like it for that. But Nancy's question was specifically about using lifting all 10 toes as a way to feel that you can then drive your weight through your heels. That was more the question. And we should know that when we drive through the heels or shift our weight back into our heels and then do a movement, that the more we shift the weight posteriorly in the feet, the more that connects us to using our posterior chain, the muscles of the back body. So sometimes that could be helpful depending on the movement that we're doing. Some movements are posterior chain driven movements, and they might pair really well with feeling the weight drive down through your heels. But then other movements are not really posterior chain movements, so I'm not sure how helpful it is to actively cue people to lift their toes and feel that they can drive through their heels. So let's just look at a couple examples to make this a little more concrete. Nancy asked both about strength training, like strength exercises, and about yoga. So let's kind of make this about both. So there's a movement that you may very well be familiar with called a deadlift. This is a strength exercise where we reach down and we pick up a weight off the floor, a deadlift. Now, a deadlift is a movement that is meant to be a posterior chain driven movement. It's a movement that's designed to kind of strengthen through the back body. Like primarily, there are, you know, it's more complex than just that, but primarily back body. So let's look at a Romanian deadlift. This is a good example because this has a good crossover with a movement we do in yoga that I'll show you in a sec. But in a Romanian deadlift, the idea is that we shift our hips back, reach down, pick up our weight, and come on up, and then we lower it back down. So this movement is really intending to load my posterior chain, especially hamstrings here, my glutes work, my spinal extensors, kind of all of that posterior chain stuff. And I can really help facilitate that by, yes, feeling like I can drive through my heels. And it might be a helpful cue to just see, like, can I lift my toes off the floor? That may help me better sense that my weight is more down in my heels. So it could be a good awareness tool to do that and really appropriate in a deadlift. And then we could think about yoga, where we have a similar looking movement to the Romanian deadlift, which is our halfway lift, our Ardha Uttanasana. So similar like joint positions to the Romanian deadlift, but different context, of course. This is yoga. We're not lifting weights, but we are in a movement that is targeting the posterior chain here. Like if I didn't, you know, rest my hands on my shins and if I held them here, then my hamstrings would be working actively to hold me in this position. So posterior chain. So in a halfway lift, perhaps we might want to, you know, occasionally maybe ask people to really feel that their weight is in their heels and that they could lift their toes as just a way to check on that. I could see that being like appropriate and helpful in something like a halfway lift position or in any other place in yoga where we're specifically trying to get into the back body. But Nancy, she actually didn't ask about deadlifts. She asked about squats. So she said that in the weightlifting classes that she is in, sometimes she'll hear this cue for a squat that we should lift all 10 toes and then shift the weight back into the heels. So let's look at a squat really quickly. To me, a squat, a strength training squat, is very similar to Utkatasana or chair pose in yoga. So they have a lot of overlap. But basically, a strength training squat, you would hold maybe a weight at your chest or on your back, something like that. And then you simply lower down and lift back up. So the mechanics involved here are different than the deadlift. So the deadlift, you know, the weight was down and it was more like back and up, especially the Romanian deadlift that I demonstrated. And then a squat is more straight down and straight up. So, and a squat, like I said, is also similar mechanics-wise to a chair pose where we kind of just lower straight down and lift back up. So in both of those movements, those are not actually primarily posterior chain movements like the deadlift was. Squats and chair pose are much more, the work is more evenly distributed through the front and back, the anterior and posterior. And especially in squats, we have a lot of work in the quads, which are our front thigh muscles. So very much anterior chain. So because of that, we probably don't, in those movements, it probably doesn't really help us facilitate the movement pattern that we're after if we ask ourselves or our students to lift all 10 toes and drive the weight through the heels, because that's not really what we want in a squat. In a squat, we're probably better served by distributing our weight just evenly across the foot front to back and lowering straight down so that we can recruit both the front and the back. So, yeah, I probably personally would not cue lift the toes, shift your weight into the heels for a squat, but maybe for a deadlift. And then let's just look at a third squat variation just to make this point a little bit, because I think this is helpful. But there are certain squat variations where we very intentionally try to send the knees really far forward as a good way to strengthen our knees through a greater range of motion, to strengthen the quadriceps muscles through a greater range of motion, maybe to work on ankle dorsiflexion mobility. There are a lot of reasons why we might want to teach that or practice that ourselves. So let's say we're doing something called a knees over toes split squat, which looks something like this, where we go forward, see how my knee is really far forward over the toes, and then we come back up and forward and back. So this is a movement in which it's not posterior chain like the deadlift, and it's not even lowering straight down like a typical squat. This is much more of a forward movement, like I'm really trying to reach forward. And because of that, I'm going to necessarily be loading into the front of my foot. In fact, in order to come into this position, all five of my toes on the front foot, they need to push down into the floor to help like resist and keep control, maintain control of this movement. So in something where we really have this emphasis on knees forward, it actually maybe probably would be counterproductive to teach lift all 10 toes and shift your weight back into your heels, because that would just really work against what we're after in the pose and the movement that we're doing. We need not only to not lift the toes, but we need the toes to be able to press down. We need active toe flexion into the floor in order to help control and work in that movement. So anyway, that's just an example kind of going toward the other end of the spectrum of where everything is more anterior. And yeah, pretty much no, it wouldn't be very helpful to try to lift the toes there and send the weight into the heels. So all of that is just to say, you know, cues like lift the 10 toes cue, but all of our cues in yoga are, you know, should be very context specific and specific to our goal and our intention in the moment. And like, why are we using them? So as we could see, it can be, you know, a little complex. Like there's more that we might think about when it comes to lifting the toes. And then as just a final point, I just wanted to point out that, like I said, I've experienced personally that in some schools of yoga, there is quite a bit of emphasis on lifting the toes, whether it's to send the weight into the heels or not. Sometimes it's just that like lifting the toes is just an inherently good thing to do. It will activate the feet or activate the lower leg. And we should just pretty much do this in many of our poses. Like kind of this emphasis on lifting the toes is just being inherently good. But what I'd like to point out about that is, first of all, I don't think there's anything wrong with lifting the toes, but it's not that flexing the toes. So lifting the toes is toe extension, but flexing the toes would be like pressing the toes into the floor or really curling the toes. It's not the case that curling the toes is bad and lifting the toes is good. You know, like there's not, we don't need to have this emphasis on one being good versus one being bad. And there are many cases in which toe flexion, like pushing the toes down, can be super helpful. So one example of that is when we may want to intentionally strengthen the arches of the feet. So if you've ever, you may be familiar with this, it's kind of common, like it is common in the physical therapy and the rehab world, but there's something called a towel curl. And this is a movement specifically intended, it will strengthen the toe flexors, but the idea is that it also will help support the arches and maybe strengthen the arches. So you just take a towel and then you scrunch it with your toes, like you're intentionally trying to scrunch that towel up. And by doing that, you're actively working the toe flexors and some intrinsic muscles in the feet. And that is also working to support the arches, specifically the medial longitudinal arch, that kind of big main one that we tend to think about. So the towel curl is an exercise where we intentionally flex the toes. And then just, you know, as a FYI or an extra point about that is there's another exercise called short foot, which doesn't use the towel. And that's one, it's super subtle, but you basically just try to shorten your foot from the ball of the foot to the heel, like shorten that space. It's called short foot. And the idea is that you actually do that without curling the toes, but that's another exercise in which we would intentionally be working to like strengthen the arches. And research tends to suggest that the short foot is maybe more effective for strengthening the arches, but in general, it's a good comprehensive approach to do both like towel curls and short foot. And then of course, lots of other things as well. Like we can strengthen our feet and the arches by doing a lot of like bigger movements, maybe where we're holding load, and a lot of our like strength exercises would translate down to building strength in the feet. But if we really want to isolate it, towel curl and short foot. So I just want to point those out because I just think it's interesting to kind of contrast that with sometimes this emphasis we sometimes see on like lifting the toes in yoga a lot, as though that's somehow inherently good. It's certainly good, but also curling the toes can be good and shortening the foot can be good. And ideally, you know, if we really want to target the foot in a well-rounded manner, we would think of loading and moving it in a well-rounded way from all directions. And we could do both isolated things and also bigger movements that are more compound. So that's a little bit, that's kind of not quite what Nancy was asking, I know, but I just think it's interesting to throw in there just to more broadly think about what are we doing with our toes in yoga? What are we cueing in yoga around the toes, the feet, the arches? I like the tripod or the foot thing, focusing on that. I feel like that'll kind of just gets everything to kind of self-organize and figure itself out without needing to be too directive in like a top-down detailed manner. But that's just like kind of my approach to it. Anyway, I hope this was helpful for thinking about lifting all 10 toes and like whether, when, and why we might want to do that or teach that.